gave his life for us, to save us, to bring us together, to be with him, to be his family, his children on earth. We thank you, Lord. Let's sing together, standing on the promises of God.
Standing on the promises of Christ, my King, through eternal ages let his praises ring. Glory in the highest, I will shout and sing. Standing on the promises of God, standing on the promises of God, my Savior, standing. I'm standing on the promises of God, standing on the promises that cannot fail. When the howling storms of doubt and fear assail, by the living word of God I shall prevail. Standing on the promises of God, standing on the promises of God, my Savior, promises of God, standing on the promises I now can see, perfect threads and cleansing in the blood for me, standing in the liberty where Christ makes free, standing on the promises of God. Promises of God, my Savior, standing. I'm standing on the promises of God, standing on the promises of Christ the Lord, born to him eternally by love's strong cord, overcoming daily with the Spirit's sword, standing on the promises of God, standing on the promises of God, my Savior, of God, standing on the promises I cannot fail, listening every moment to the Spirit's call, resting in my Savior as my all and all, standing on the promises of God.
Welcome, everyone. You may be seated. Let me run them through a few things, take your bulletins and look at them this morning, kind of make sure we're all on the same page throughout the week and the days that lie ahead. I want to mention that tonight, of course, is the Knights of the King's Table, which is the Scripture Memory Program here at Grace Community Church. And again, we've had one so far in September. We have one each month except for December during the school year. And we had a great turnout, so don't let me down tonight. All of you guys that were there last week, don't say, oh, I don't think I'll go this much. Yes, you got to make a commitment to hiding the Word of God in your heart, you need to stick to it. So do that and be there tonight. And tonight, Dean Mertens is in charge of the refreshments, and he's told me we're having a Linda Groves Memorial Night because it's Sloppy Joe's. And Linda was the queen of Sloppy Joe's. So be there to enjoy the Sloppy Joe's. But also, we're going to be playing Wheel of Fortune as the game to memorize scripture with. So it's going to be a great time tonight. Also, I'm going to mention the men's Bible study Tuesday night. Bill Snyder, 6:30 p.m., discussion of 1 Kings. Don't forget that, men. There's also a new members class I need to mention that Randy Slack will be running. Talk to Randy Slack if you would like to be in that membership, if you're interested in being a member here at Grace Community Church. It's going to take place on Thursday, October 26th, and another one on November the 2nd, two classes in room 204. It'll be 6:30 in the evening. Then also we'll mention that one of our outgoing ministries, Grace to the Streets here, is going to take place Monday, October the 30th at the Milwaukee Bucks game. And Jarrett Klingler, if you'd like to be a part of that. So that's going to be at the Pfizer Forum, of course. And they'll be passing out tracts and so forth. So if you have a zeal for the Lord and you'd like to just hand out tracts and maybe talk to some people about the gospel, do that. Okay, I think that's all the announcements that I have. And so now I'm going to go into a video here that I want you to listen to, and then we'll go.
Hi, this is it. Pastor Hung Lin from Yangon, Myanmar. Thank you so much for your love and support for Spiritual Boot Camp for our country. It is a big blessing. We conducted more than 50 times, and we reach many young people and many ministers and pastors around in our country. We would like to request to you continue praying for Spiritual Boot Camp for our country, and we are praying to do more training for our country, many area, and we want to share Spiritual Boot Camp to other people and other churches around in our country. Thank you so much for your love, for your support, and for the Spiritual Boot Camp. And thanks again. Please continue praying for our country and Spiritual Boot Camp conference for our country. Thank you so much and God bless you. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Our friend Hung Lin, some of you remember we brought him to the States not too long ago. They've been suffering still. The military oppression in Myanmar is very great. He lost a brother who was shot and killed by a soldier. Also, just this past week I received flooding. Is another problem right now in Myanmar, and the very center they worship in and have their little Bible Institute in was flooded, and they had water all over the floor and so forth. So be praying for Hung Lin. And I gave this video because this is the week of our missions banquet this coming Saturday. You can still RSVP today, or I think up till Tuesday in the office. But we want you to sign up. Please sign up, and please make a point to be there. It's going to be lots of excitement, lots of fun. Remember, Jesus gave us a great commission, and we are to go into all the world and to preach the gospel and to make disciples, right? That's the great commission he's given to the church. The question is, have you been paying any attention to that? Have you been obeying Christ's command? Is there something you can do to help carry out his great commission? Well, one way you can do is to be there next Saturday and look at, there's videos, not only this video, but there are other videos of other SBC representatives, discipleship representatives around the world. And there's going to be special music, going to be slideshows, and a variety of sample foods from different countries. It's going to be a lot of fun activities for the kids, too. So mark it down on your calendar, RSVP as well, and be here next Saturday.
Hey, what about KKT?
Good morning, Grace Community Church.
Morning, all around.
God is what?
Good.
All the time. Amen. I'm going to be reading from Psalm 34 before we go into prayer. I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. My soul shall make its boast in the Lord. The humble shall hear of it and be glad. Oh, magnify the Lord with me, and let us exalt his name together. I sought the Lord, and he heard me, and delivered me from all my fears. They looked to him and were radiant, and their faces were not ashamed. This poor man cried out, and the Lord heard him and saved him out of his troubles. The angel of the Lord encamps all around those that fear him. He delivers them. Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man who trusts in him. Oh, fear the Lord, you his saints. There is no want to those who fear him. But those who seek the Lord shall not lack any good thing. Come, you children, listen to me. I will teach you the fear of the Lord. Let's pray. My dear Heavenly Father, you alone are worthy of our praise. As we gathered before you today, you created this universe for your good pleasure and for us to be able to live in and enjoy this minute part of the universe. After you had created the world and all that is in it, you tell us in your word that it was very good. Your word also tells us that the heavens declare the glory of God and the earth shows forth its handiwork. We thank you too for revealing yourself to us through your word, for giving us faith to believe in it, and for saving us from your wrath against sin and giving us a new life in and through the shed blood of Jesus Christ on the cross of Calvary. Father, your word also declares that we should pray for the peace of Jerusalem. And it is with heavy hearts that we come before you and ask that you would have mercy on your children who love you, and also for the rest of your chosen people in Israel. We pray that you would stay the hand of the evil one and bring peace to that nation. And we thank you for that, Lord. We also pray for our nation. Lord, we are steeped in sin, the sin of sacrificing babies because we do not want to have to deal with the consequences of our sinfulness. The people are refusing to accept the fact that your word declares when you created mankind that they were created as male and female. Then there is continuing violence and the people are killing each other, robbing each other, and Lord, the list goes on. And we just pray, Father, that you would work in the hearts of people and cause them to realize just who you are and what you have to offer them. We pray, too, for the leaders of our country and ask that you would bring an end to the corruption that exists, that you would empower your loved ones that are in high places to stand firmly for you and to be a good example to those who don't know you. Father, we pray for our missionaries and ask that you continue to bless and strengthen them in their work for you. We especially ask your hand of protection on your loved ones in Myanmar, Lord. All we can ask is that you help them and give them courage to trust and stand fast in their faith. And we ask that you undertake to do this because they're going through terrible times of persecution, and we just pray for your protection on them, Lord. We pray for our members here at GCC, Lord. There are many among us who are dealing with cancer. Please continue to strengthen us to trust in you alone, Lord. Lord, that you would pour out your grace and mercy upon us. There are others among us with degenerative diseases. Have mercy on us, dear Lord. Some of us have recovering from various surgeries and illnesses. We ask for complete healing in accordance to your will, Lord. Thank you, Lord, too, that we can bring these requests before you. We do ask that our worship this morning would glorify your name and that you would empower Pastor Ted as he brings the message to us today. For these and all your many mercies, Lord, we give you thanks. And then through the wonderful name of our Lord Jesus Christ, amen.
Audience falling apart up here today. Now, before we go ahead today, I want to take our spot, our scripture memory place. We, every Sunday morning, as an important part of our worship service, we have the scripture memory section that's connected with our Knights of the King's Table memory program tonight. So let's all stand together. Congregation, we ask you to memorize these verses. We give them to you each week. This particular one for this week is a long one, and so therefore we've given you 2 weeks, and this is the first week we're trying to repeat it, okay? So As you do it, though, you'll notice that it says, love not the world. And I ran across something, and I used this for the elders meeting this past week. But there's a little devotional with a little phrase in it by D. Martin Lloyd-Jones, as you know, is one of my favorite guys and commentators, about what is the world. And when it says, love not the world, or the things of the world, what is it talking about? Well, it's not talking about the beautiful creation, the mountains and the stars and all that. Listen to what he says. What does the scripture mean when it says, love not the world? Christians should not love the world. He's referring to the organization and the mind and the outlook of mankind as it ignores God and does not recognize him, and as it lives a life of independence from him. Doesn't have time for church on Sunday mornings, is not interested in the word of God and so forth. They're doing things the way God says to do them. A life that's based upon this world and this life only. It's the whole outlook upon life that is exclusive of God. That's a good definition of what is the world. All right, so let's read it together, and then let's have you, just a second here. Let's have you try to recite it with me, okay? Here we go, 1 John 2:15 to 17. Love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. If any man love the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life, is not of the Father, but is of the world. And the world passeth away, and the lust thereof. And he that doeth the will of God abideth forever.
Amen.
Should be an old familiar one to most of you, and not too hard, even though it's kind of long. So let's try it without the overhead, okay? 1 John 2:15 and 17. Love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. For if any man love the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life, is not of the Father, but is of the world. And the world passeth away in the lust thereof. But he that doeth the will of God abideth forever. Not bad. A little slow, but not bad.
Let us continue with our singing to each other and to the Lord as we are in the presence of our Lord Jesus Christ. I stand amazed in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene, and wonder how he can love me, a sinner condemned, unclean. How marvelous, shall ever be. How wonderful is my Savior's love for me. For me it was in the to comfort him.
sorrows he bore for my soul that night. How marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me.
Praise you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord.
He took my sins and my sorrows and made them his very own. He bore the burden to Calvary and suffered and died alone. How marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever and with the ransomed in glory, his face I at last shall see. It will be my joy through the ages to sing of his love for me. Shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me. How marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. How marvelous, Savior's love for me. How deep the Father's love for us, how vast beyond all measure, that he should give his only Son to make a wretch his treasure. How great the pain of sin. Which mar the chosen one, bring many sons to glory. Behold the man up on a cross, my sin upon his shoulders. Ashamed, I hear my mocking voice call out among the scoffers. It was my sin that held him there until it lost in anything. No gifts, no power, no wisdom, but I will boast in Jesus Christ, His death and resurrection. Why should I gain from His reward? I cannot give an answer, but this I know with all my heart, His wounds have paid my ransom. Why should
we thank you, Lord. We can never give you enough thanks, Father, for you've done so much for us, and you've blessed us with so much, and you've given us eternal life, a life with you. Lord, we thank you, and we sing about you. We sing about your wondrous mystery, the mystery that has been revealed to us as after you resurrected from the grave, that we should be part of your eternal family, Jews and Gentiles, as the promise was first given to them, then revealed and given to us. We thank you.
Come behold the wondrous mystery in the dawning of the King. He the theme of heaven's praises, robed in frail humanity. In the longing, in the darkness, now the light of life has come. Look to Christ who condescended, took on flesh to ransom us. Come behold the wondrous mystery, He the perfect Son of Man, with His living in His suffering, never trace nor stain of sin. See the true and better Adam come to save the hell-bound man. Christ the great and sure fulfillment of the law, in Him we stand. The Lord upon a tree, in the stead of ruined sinners, hangs the Lamb in victory. See the price of our redemption, see the Father's plan unfold, bringing many sons to glory, grace unmeasured, love untold. Come behold the wondrous mystery, slain by death the God of life. But no grave could e'er restrain him. Praise the Lord, he is alive. What a foretaste of deliverance, how unwavering our foe. Christ in power resurrected, as we will be when he comes. What a foretaste of deliverance, how unwavering our hope. Christ in
let's bow and pray at the beginning. Our Father and our God, there's a great need in our time for Christians to understand the doctrine of your sovereign and providential watch care over them. There's great spiritual darkness in our time, and we're surrounded by many manifestations of evil and corruption that cause us to be fearful and anxious within the war in Israel right now. Too often we do not see beyond the immediate causes and those things that are tangible and visible to the naked eye. And as a result, it's tempting to think that you have nothing to do with what happens in this world. But your word teaches that there's not a single molecule in the entire universe that's outside the scope of your sovereign, providential control. And this should be a comforting truth for us. And so we pray that as we consider this truth today, that you would give us a deeper and greater understanding and appreciation of the sovereign rule and reign that you exercise over the earth and everything in it. We ask in Christ our Lord's name. Amen. The subject of our study today is the providential watch care of God. And I believe that this is a much needed message because it's a vital truth that for the most part has been lost in our culture and in our world today. People in the 16th, 17th, and 18th centuries had a much more awareness and a sense of the presence of God and his providential watch care over their lives, the Puritans and so forth. We have a city here in the USA that's called Providence, Rhode Island. And it was named that in the 18th century and probably before that, by a generation of people with a worldview that included a God who ruled over the direction and government of their personal lives and also collectively as a community and we as a nation. You can go to Washington, D.C., and you can read the archives of the founding fathers of our country, and I've done this before, men like Benjamin Franklin and John Adams, and you will see in those founding fathers and their documents numerous references to the providential working of God in the direction of history and in people's personal lives. Like many other Christians in our generation here in the United States, I'm a great fan of the late pastor, teacher, scholar, R.C. Sproul. And he has had what's called the Ligonier Ministries, which is still in existence today. And recently, I've been listening to some of his lectures on the providence of God, and that's what inspired this message today. And I found this material for me to be a source of great refreshment and renewal and a source of comfort for my soul. And I've been exposed to teaching about the sovereignty of God and his providential control in all things for many years in my life, from men like A.W. Pink and Jerry Bridges and D. Martin Lloyd-Jones. At this point, I want to hold up a couple books. I told the bookstore lady that I'd be doing this. One of them is by A.W. Pink, and this book turned my life around when I was about 18, 19, 20, something like that. And it taught me about the doctrine of God's sovereignty. And a lot of things have changed in my theology as the years gone by, but the sovereignty of God has not budged one iota, not one inch. I recommend. It's heavy reading, and you have to be serious to know what the sovereignty of God is. Look up scriptures. But anyway, it's Sovereignty of God by A.W. Pink. And they may have some copies at the book table, but she can tell you how to get it, or you can just go online and find it yourself, I'm sure. The other one is a book by Jerry Bridges called Trusting God Even When It Hurts. And this is a practical application of God's providential working. What happens, you know, you've heard this question before, why is it that bad things happen to good people? A lot of times people say, why God? And Jerry Bridges addresses this aspect of the same subject that we're talking about today. But the doctrine, so it's been a great source of comfort for me, this doctrine we're talking about today, over the years. But also, I've noticed, I am the founding pastor of this church, and I have noticed over the years a number of people have left this church about this very doctrine, because they do not want to hear about a sovereign God. They don't want to hear about the doctrine of providence and God's in control of everything. And so it creates disagreement and conflict among believers, but for me it's a source of great comfort. Our church is Reformed in theology, Grace Community Church. And at the heart of Reformed theology is the doctrine of the sovereignty of God, the fact that God is absolutely sovereign in all things. And this includes the belief in the providential working of God in all circumstances and in all events all the time. And many have left this church and other Reformed churches like it because they don't want this idea of a God who, again, is sovereign. They think man has the power to overrule the will of God. So this sermon, which is probably going to be more teaching than preaching, which comes naturally because my gift is teaching, and I was a teacher before I was a pastor. So the sermon will be for more teaching than preaching. We're going to examine the doctrine of the providential watch care of God, especially as it affects the lives of Christian men and women. And from the beginning, I had to acknowledge that I'm dwelling heavily on the doctrine of the lectures, that is, of R.C. Sproul and other scholars. And I'll often be using their own words to more accurately present this doctrine. And you can listen to these lectures yourself by R.C. Sproul and the Ligonier Ministries website and so forth. But as you're going to see, this is a deep, heavy subject, heavy stuff. And I do not pretend to be able to adequately cover this subject on my own, especially in one sermon, nor am I able to adequately describe some of these truths in my own words. So I need to rely heavily upon the very words of some of these teachers who are far greater scholars than I. So that means, translated, that means I'm going to be reading a lot of quotes today. And in the beginning, I need to set the stage by comparing some different worldviews of people which contribute to their belief or unbelief in the sovereign providential working of God. R.C. Sproul commented, I'm quoting Sproul now, he says, one of the dominant concepts for the last 100 years in Western society is the idea that we live in a closed, mechanistic universe. That is to say that there's no possibility for intrusion from outside, says Sproul, and that everything operated here according to naturally fixed laws of the universe is sort of like a machine that functions on its own inner machinations. But even those who introduced that idea, says Sproul, as early as the 17th and 18th century, still posited the idea of a God who built the machine in the first place. Those people they couldn't get away from the need for the idea of a creator, because those people were intelligent thinkers and scientists. And they said, look, we couldn't have a scientific world and to be observing if there isn't some kind of ultimate cause for all these things. In other words, what you and I would call an intelligent designer. Why the flowers? Why the critters? Why the way your eye works? Why the miracle of how your body divides mitosis and reproduces with chromosomes and genes and all of that kind of thing? Even the idea of an involved providential governor who of the daily affairs of life, even though that was being questioned and challenged in that early time, still it was assumed that there had to be a creator. And in our own days, that's kind of disappeared. In our own times, modern scientists, theologians, and philosophers have rejected the idea of an intelligent creator. In other words, the God who stands behind the creation. But in the classical concept of providence, we need to say here, with respect to Christian theology, The idea of God's providence, his providential sovereign control of all things, is very closely bound up with his role as the creator of the universe, the maker of it all. Because, as I said, it's not simply that God creates the universe and then turns his back on it and loses touch with it. It's not simply that God sits on his throne in heaven and watches this machine work out its own inner mechanism. And here I want to inject vocabulary. Again, when I was a teacher, we used to do lectures and teach lessons, and the students were given vocabulary words, key words, that they had to write down and then later on and be able to define them. And I told you today, if you read the news, the little flash that was put out by Mary, the secretary, the mass email, to be ready to take notes today and be ready to be prepared to. And so I'm going to give you some vocabulary words today. So different men have different eyes about God, or different ideas about God when it comes to explaining the idea of God's sovereignty. Louis Berkhof, in his systematic theology, explains, especially in the 17th and 18th centuries, theologians in the Catholic Church and Armenian theologians set forth what's called deism. There's your first vocabulary word, deism. And here's what Berkhof says about this, and I'm quoting Berkhof now, great theologian. He says, according to deism, God's concern with the world is not universal, special, and perpetual, but only of a general nature. At the time of creation, he imparted to all of his creatures certain inalienable properties and placed them under invariable laws. And then he left it to work out their own destiny by their own inherent powers. Meanwhile, he exercises a general oversight, not of the specific agents that appear on the scene, but of the general laws which he put in place. The world is simply a machine, according to deism, which God has put in motion, and not at all a vessel which he pilots from day to day. But as R.C. Sproul argues from the biblical perspective, as God is the primary cause of the universe, he's also the primary cause, and listen to this, this is our subject today. Not only is he the primary cause of the universe to begin with, but he also is the cause of everything in the universe and everything that takes place in the universe. Again, the foundational principle of Christian theology is that nothing, no thing in this world has intrinsic causal power. Nothing has any power save the power that is vested in it or loaned to it, if you will, or worked through it, which ultimately is the power of God. Now, says Sproul, that doesn't mean, and I'm not saying that I don't have any power to do anything or that you don't have any power to do anything. I'm saying you don't have it in and of yourselves. You don't have it by your own strength eternally. And that's why theologians and philosophers historically have made a critical distinction between what is called, here's vocabulary words, are you ready? Write them down. Vocabulary words. They have made, scientists and philosophers have made a distinction between primary causality and secondary causality. Primary causality and secondary causality. The fact that God is primary means that he's the first cause. He's the author of all that is. And not only back then in time when he created the world, but he continues to be the primary cause in human history and in the natural occurrences. Now, that primary cause doesn't exclude secondary causes. It doesn't mean that he works apart from us and that there's no such thing as a causal link or connection in nature between the primary cause and the secondary cause, because there is. And then Sproul uses this illustration. Follow along. He says, we're saying, and I'm quoting Sproul now, he says, we're saying that when the rain falls, the grass gets wet. Not because God makes the grass wet directly and immediately without the falling of the rain. It's the rain that causes the grass to get wet. But the point I'm saying, he says, is that the rain couldn't fall, or even if it did fall, the grass couldn't get wet if it weren't for the causal power of God that stands over and above that secondary activity that's taking place. In contrast, he says, the modern man has cut off at the knees and says that we have the rain and we have the wet grass and we don't need the primary cause. We can do just fine with the secondary causes, and never mind the primary causes. That's modern man. Now, the simple concept that we have here is this. What God creates, he sustains. That's the providential working of God, his sovereignty over everyday life. So one of the important subdivisions under the concept of providence in theology is the concept of divine sustenance, another vocabulary word.
divine sustenance. Is this heavy stuff? I told you it would be. But follow along. So this concept of divine sustenance, that is that God is not the great watchmaker that winds up the watch, winds it up and then steps out of the picture, but he makes it and he preserves it and he sustains it. Sproul goes on to point out that another one of the most profoundly significant concepts in all the world is the concept of God as the author of being. Stay with me. God as the author of being. Sproul says, you could not be without a supreme being because you don't have the power of being. And if any pagan or if any atheist in the United States would think about being seriously and logically for 5 minutes, it'd be the end of atheism. Because everyone knows as well as they know anything that no one in this world has the power of being within himself. And yet somewhere there must be someone who does have the power of being within himself, or it'd be absolutely scientifically impossible for anything to be. If there's no supreme being, folks, there would be no being. There's nothing. And if there's something, there must be something that has the power of being, or nothing would be. It's that simple. That's simple for Sproul. If you don't have a PhD, he says, you don't have to have a PhD in philosophy. Let me say it again, he says. If anything exists, then something must have the power of being within itself, or nothing would be. It's that simple, he says. So, the point we're making here is that the Apostle Paul, it's the point that the Apostle Paul had when he spoke to the pagans of his day in the books of Acts, in Acts chapter 17, to the Greeks at Athens. When he said, and you'll remember this passage, how they had an altar to the unknown God. You remember that? An altar to the unknown God. And he said, whom you worship in ignorance. And then he said, I declare to you that it is in him that we move, that we live and move and have our being. That is, that God does it. What God does is that when he creates, whatever exists is not dependent upon God's power. That whatever he creates is not only dependent on God's power for its origin or existence, it's also dependent on the power of God for its continuity and its existence. That's the important point. Now, there's also another man-made theory of God, another vocabulary term for you, that's called pantheism. Write it down, pantheism. In an article on pantheism in the Evangelical Dictionary of Theology, C.E. Plumpter says this, and I'm quoting this scholar, Plumpter. He says, the word pantheism comes from the Greek pan and theos, which means pan, everything, and God, theos. In other words, God is everything, which means the material universe is God. It is God. That's what this view of pantheism is. It's not what I'm teaching. It was coined by John T. Tolan in 1705 to refer to a philosophical system. Pantheism rejects the biblical teaching of the transcendence of God, whereas biblical theism distinguishes between God and the world. The biblical understanding of God and the world is that God is eternal and the world is finite. In other words, God exists. Listen to this. The biblical teaching is that God exists above and apart from the world. The world is not God, this pantheism surmises. This means the words of the apostle in Acts 17, when Paul said, it is in him, in this God, that we live and move and have our being, those words have reference to God's providential work in upholding the being of mankind and of the world and of governing it all. God holds the creation in existence that he's created, and he even works through it and in it. Now, having said all this, let me go to the Westminster Confession of Faith and its definition of God's providential rule in all things. And we're going to use this and stay with me on it. Here it is. This is the classic... A classic confession of the faith that's historical, the Westminster Confession. And then chapter 3, article 1, it says, God, from all eternity, did by the most wise and holy counsel of his own will, freely and unchangeably ordain whatsoever comes to pass, so that as thereby neither is God the author of sin, nor is violence offered to the will of the creatures, nor is the liberty or contingency of second causes taken away, but rather established. Now, we're going to take that apart. and look at it phrase by phrase. Now, the first phrase says, God from all eternity did by the most wise and holy counsel of his own free will unchangeably ordain whatsoever comes to pass. Now, right away, I know this is very difficult teaching for people to believe and accept. But the question is it taught in Scripture, God's Word? And if it's taught in Scripture, what do we have to say as Christians? Amen. It's true. And it is taught in Scripture. Here you go. Write down the references. Ephesians chapter 1, verse 11. In him we were also chosen, having been predestined. That's another word that people don't like. Having been predestined according to the plan. God has a plan. According to the plan of him who works out everything in accordance or in conformity to the purpose of his will. Ephesians 1:11 says God works everything in conformity to the purpose that he has of his will. And God has a purpose, a plan that he's working out in everything to accomplish what he pleases. Let me read the words in Isaiah 46, 9 through 11 to you. Not all of them, but some of them. Isaiah 46, this mark it down in your notes. God says through the prophet Isaiah, he says, remember the former things and those of long ago. I am God and there is no other. I am God and there is none like me. I make known the end from the beginning and from ancient times what is yet to be. I say, now listen to this. God says, I say, my purpose will stand and I will do all that I please. That's God speaking. What I have said that I will bring about and what I have planned, I will do. God is going to do what he says he's going to do, and he's going to accomplish his purpose and carry it out. Ephesians chapter 3, 11, now don't got to go there, but just look sometime. It refers to it as God's eternal purpose. It actually uses those words. God has an eternal purpose. Let me read to you Ephesians 1, 9 through 11. It says, he made known to us the mystery or the secret of his will, his eternal purpose. Wow, God has made known the very secret of his eternal purpose. According to his good pleasure, which he purposed in Christ. It all has to do with Christ, the Messiah. To be put into effect when the times reach their fulfillment. What is the secret of that? What's the end of it? It says, to bring unity in all things in heaven and on earth under Christ. I don't know about you, but that gives me comfort. I know there's war in Israel, and everybody says, does this mean the end is near? Does this mean Christ is coming again? Well, I don't know all of that, but I'll say this much. God has a plan, he has a purpose, and he's going to accomplish it. It's all centered in his son who came out of heaven, the word who became flesh and dwelt among us and was born into the world. He's the son of God. And all God's eternal purpose is centered around him, Jesus Christ. And he's the savior of the world. And if you reject him, don't pay attention to him now, you're in trouble because there's going to be a final judgment day and people will be assigned to eternal glory or to eternal hell. That is the teaching of Scripture. That is the truth that God has given. But again, it says that God is working out everything in conformity with the purpose of his will. Here's another one in Hebrews chapter 6, verses 17 and 19. It says, because God wanted to make the unchangeable nature of his purpose, the unchangeable nature of his purpose, God wanted to make this very clear to the heirs of what was promised to Christians. He confirmed it with an oath. God did this so that by two unchangeable things, which is impossible for God to lie, we who have fled to take hold of this hope, Christians, that set before us, that we may be greatly encouraged. And we have this hope as an anchor for the soul, firm and secure. That is to say, you have it if you are a believer in the Lord Jesus Christ, and he is your personal Lord and Savior. Here's another one. You writing these down? Romans 8:28. You ever heard of that one before? And it says, you don't pay attention to the words, though. And we know that what? In all things, everything, all the details of your life, your circumstances every day, in all things, God works for the good of those who love him, who have been called according to his purpose. In Romans 11:36, this is beautiful. Romans 11:36, for from him and through him and to him are all things. All things come from God. He sustains them and works them, and all things will ultimately be accountable to him, whether you believe it or not. Next, second phrase of the Westminster Confession. It says, yet this is so as thereby neither is God the author of sin, this doesn't make God the author of sin, nor is violence offered to the will of creatures. Now let me give you some scriptures under this. that point out that God is not the author of sin. James 1, 13 and 17 says, when tempted, no one should say, God is tempting me, for God cannot be tempted by evil, nor does he tempt anyone. God, in other words, does not cause anyone to sin. He's not the author of sin. Verse 17 says, every good and perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father and the Heavenly Father and the heavenly lights, who does not change. God who does not change like shifting shadows. In other words, God is immutably good. He can't change. And at no point can he become the author of sin suddenly. 1 John 1:5 says, this is the message we have heard from him and declare unto you, God is light, and in him is no darkness at all. There's no sin in God. He's not the author of sin. 1 John 3:5, he appeared so that he might take away our sins, and in him is no sin. Titus 1:2, in hope of eternal life, which God who cannot lie promised before the beginning of time. So those scriptures help us understand. The Bible declares God is not sin. He has no sin. He's not the author of sin. So where does sin come from? Is that the question you're asking? So where does sin come from? We can read the account of it in Ezekiel 28, 11 to 19. I'm going to read it for you. It's on the screen. Ezekiel 28, Ezekiel the prophet in the Old Testament, verses 11 to 20. From the beginning, what this passage says, that in all of God's creation, sin had its origin, not in God, but in a creature, a fallen angel that we've come to know as Lucifer or Satan. Now, this passage, most scholars recognize that it has a higher reference. It's not just, seems like it's addressed to the king of Tyre. But when you read it, it's very, very obvious that it has a higher reference to an angelic being who is a fallen being and a fallen angel. Here it is. It says, you were the seal of perfection. God is talking to this creature. You were the seal of perfection, full of wisdom and perfect in beauty, you were. You were in Eden and in the garden of God. That's not referring to some man here on earth. It's referring to an angel, angelic being in heaven. You were in Eden, the garden of God. Every precious stone adorned you. And then it mentions these precious stones, carnelian, chrysolite, and emerald, and so forth. And it says, your settings and mountings were made of gold on the day. Look, it says, on the day you were created. See, this is a creature. It is a created being, and it's describing the words are clearly indicative of an angelic being. So it says, on the day you were created, they were prepared. You were anointed as a guardian cherub. It even calls him a guardian cherub. It's talking about a fallen angel here. For so I ordained you in the beginning. You were on the holy mount of God. You walked with the fiery stones. Look at this. It says, now carefully in verse 15. You were blameless in all your ways. You were blameless in all your ways from the day you were created till wickedness was found in you. Are you with me? Where did sin come from? From one of the creatures of God who willed to rebel against God, and wickedness was found in him. Well, then the question comes in this, and some of you probably think of this. Since God is omniscient, right? God knows everything. He knows all things before they happen. Then isn't he the author of sin because he created and made creatures that he knew would sin because he knows everything? And the answer to that question is no. That doesn't make God the author of sin. It's true that since God ordains whatever comes to pass, he did ordain that sin would exist in this creation. But that does not make him the author or the cause of sin. Rather, the teaching of Scripture is that he allowed sin to come into existence through his fallen creature, Satan, and fallen mankind. And as the Confession of Faith says, this was by the most wise and holy counsel of his own will to use it to manifest the glory of his mercy, his grace, and his compassion, and his steadfast love. Think about it. Think about it, my friends. Without the presence of sin in the creation, God would not have been able to demonstrate his amazing love and grace and compassion and mercy that he has as his attributes through his beloved son, Jesus Christ, because there'd be no sin to save you from, you see. That act of love on Calvary's cross is at the center of God's whole eternal purpose that we've been talking about, his plan that he conceived before the foundation of the world and the solution of it for a lost and condemned world. Now, there's an important point of qualification here that I have to mention. None of this is to say, as some people have suggested, that sin is therefore ultimately something good. In other words, that Satan or Judas, who betrayed Jesus, in the end could argue that what they did may have seemed evil, but after all, it was good. No. This is the reason hell exists, as a proof of God's hatred of sin and the wickedness of evil, and as an eternal reminder of the justice of God. See, God couldn't manifest his justice this way, or his love, or his mercy, or anything else, if there were not sin in the creation. And yet God's not the author of sin, but is the solution of it. He manifests his own glory. So this is to speak of something about the absolute brilliance and genius of God, that he could actually use sin, something that he did not initiate or cause, to demonstrate his grace, love, compassion, as well as his justice and his holiness. Now we go to the third phrase in the Westminster Confession. It says, nor is the liberty or contingency of secondary causes taken away, but rather it's established. R.C. Sproul says, in theology, and we're getting to another vocabulary word here, in theology and in the study of the doctrine of providence, we have a word that is very important. Here's your vocabulary word, concurrence. You ready? Concurrence. I don't know. I don't spell very good, so don't worry about it if you don't spell it right. Concurrence. And he says this simply refers to actions involving two or more parties that are taking place current with each other. And they're occurring together in somebody else's actions and they with somebody else's action. And they happen to dovetail or converge in history. In other words, you have the same activity where two or more parties are involved in that activity, and the particular role of the parties involved is not necessarily the same as the other party. The Christian doctrine of a relationship between God's divine sovereignty and human volitional actions is called the doctrine of concurrence. This is a word that we call the events that seem to merge between human actions and divine actions. Now we get into a great example. Follow me. R.C. Sproul says, my favorite illustration, and I think everybody's favorite illustration of concurrence, is the story of Joseph. And you all remember, not all of you, but hopefully many of you know the Bible well enough to remember the story of Joseph in the coat of many colors, right? Right? Right. You recall that Joseph was a favorite of his father, Jacob. And Jacob bought Joseph a technicolor coat of many colors for his birthday. And his other brothers were fiercely jealous because he got this favored treatment. And Joseph received this favored treatment from Jacob, their father. So while they were out one day, the brothers decided to kill Joseph. And by the way, this story is filled with a lot of coincidence. Coincidence is also translated the providential working of God. So follow me here. So they decided to kill him. One of the other brothers says, oh, no, we can't kill him. Finally he talked him out of killing him, but they threw him in a pit. And then they took him out of the pit, and they sold him into slavery to these caravan trailers who coincidentally just happened to be going down to Egypt. And so you know the rest of the story. Joseph is carried off to Egypt, where the caravan traders just happened coincidentally to run into one of the officers of the guard in Pharaoh's court of Potiphar. And Joseph becomes a slave in Potiphar's household. And it just happens coincidentally that Potiphar was married to an unscrupulous woman who made an illicit advance towards Joseph. And Joseph refused her advances and said, how can I sin against God in this way? And hell has no fury like a woman scorned, so she hollered, rape. And before you knew it, Joseph was thrown into prison. And while he was in prison, he just happened, coincidentally, to meet a baker, and a candlestick maker who were also in prison with him. And they have conversations, and they learn that Joseph has this ability to interpret dreams. Finally, one of them gets out of prison and tells the Pharaoh about Joseph's ability. And the Pharaoh, just so happens, coincidentally, was having nightmares. And they were troubling him in his sleep at night. Couldn't get any sleep at night. And so Joseph comes out and interprets the Pharaoh's dreams, and he does it accurately. And the Pharaoh is so thankful, full of gratitude to Joseph, that he appoints him the prime minister of Egypt. Imagine that. Coincidentally. Not by the providence of God. And all this happened at the same time there was a famine in the land. And Jacob's family were starving. So Jacob sends some of his boys up to Egypt to inquire about some of the surplus food that the prime minister, very wise prime minister, was putting in store, thoughtful enough to put in store for the Egyptian people. And so by coincidence, the brothers, many years later, just happen to meet up with Joseph. And Joseph hides his identity for a while, and then finally he reveals that he is their long-lost brother. And he embraces them with tears. And in the course of their reconciliation, the brothers are falling all over him, making apologies and so forth. And Joseph makes this very significant statement that illustrates concurrence. He says to his brothers, "You meant it for evil." What's the rest of it? "But God meant it for good." See concurrence? Here's something sinful going on in the world, but God uses it and overrules it and uses it for good. He says, "You meant it for evil." Joseph, notice, Joseph didn't whitewash the sins of his brothers. He says, "You meant it for evil. Your involvement, your volitional activity in this was evil, indeed." Joseph's brothers were guilty of sin, and it was sin that they personally wanted to do. They freely chose it. But here's the point. God stands above our choices and can work through human freedom to bring about his own providential will. And this is what Joseph is saying. He says, "You chose to do something good, but all things work together for good to them who love the Lord, those who are called according to his purpose, and I'm called according to his purpose." Now, I don't know if Joseph quoted Romans 8:28. That's what he said. So all this brings us to the conclusion that God, the God of the Bible, is absolutely sovereign, that he is indeed in control of all things and able to control all things and work them together providentially behind the scenes of this world. Jesus said, even the tiniest sparrow, what? Doesn't fall to the ground, what? Apart from the will of the Father. Even the tiniest sparrow out there in the trees. One brilliant definition of God, or not brilliant, but biblical, one biblical definition of God says, quote, "God is sovereign and absolute, he's the sovereign and absolute ruler of the universe." That's what God is by definition. He's the sovereign and absolute ruler of the universe, the source of all moral authority and supreme being. R.C. Sproul has commented that if there's one speck of cosmic dust or one molecule in the universe that's not under the control of God, then he is not sovereign. He's not God. This would mean that we could question the promises of his word, whether he's actually able to do everything that he promised, if that were so. He wouldn't have control of all things. It would mean that he was only a kindly, well-meaning grandfather type up there on the throne in heaven saying this, that, and the other thing, and then wringing his hands just hoping everything works out okay. That's the God some of you have in here. I'm telling you, it's not the God of the Word. The God of the Word is absolutely, totally sovereign and in control of all things. But because God is sovereign, he's able, and he can do what he says he's going to do. But not only is he sovereign and all-powerful, he is also a benevolent God who exercises his power for the good of the redeemed, those who are in the company of the embracing of the Savior, Jesus Christ. Listen, friends, if you're outside the sphere of Jesus Christ, if you've not received Jesus Christ, your personal Lord and Savior, and you still haven't made your mind up about God and the Bible and everything else, you're on the outside of this, and we're not talking about you today. We're talking about people who have embraced Jesus and believed on the Savior, God, the only Savior God has sent into the world. Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no one comes to the Father but by me." So it's not Pastor Groves up here ranting and raving. That's Jesus, the Son of God, who said that. And you must either accept it or reject it. Everything in creation is under the providential sustaining care of God. God doesn't only supply things, he arranges them according to his plan and glory. So I conclude then today with some examples and didn't do too bad on time. I thought I would never make it through, but here I am. I just conclude with some, you know, I'm big on the promises of God. That's why we have Knights of the King's Table tonight. And that's why we emphasize scripture memory here at God and Grace Community Church. It's because David said, "Thy word have I hid in my heart that I might not sin against you." And because Paul said, "Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly." But here they are. These promises take on new meaning. They really will touch your heart and bless your heart if you see and you know and you understand and you're instructed and taught in the doctrine of God's sovereign providential control and working in the affairs of your life. Listen, Deuteronomy 33:27, which is the key scripture for this message. The sovereign God is your refuge, and underneath are the everlasting arms. Isn't that saying what I've just been preaching? The sovereign God is your refuge, the source of hiding in this scary world we're living in. And underneath are the everlasting arms. God has you underneath no matter what. Isaiah 46:3-4. God says, listen to me, you whom I've upheld since you were conceived and carried from your birth, even in your old age and gray hairs, I am he who will sustain you and uphold you. That promise is dear, but it's even more dear when you believe, when you understand God will do and can do what he says he will. He's sovereign. He's all-powerful, omnipotent. He will do it. He'll keep his promise. Isaiah 41:10, fear not, for I am with you. Be not dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. I'll help you. I'll uphold you with the right hand of my righteousness. It takes on new meaning when you see God is indeed sovereign, omniscient. Isaiah 43:1-5, I love that one. Fear not, for I have redeemed you. He's not talking to the whole world. He's talking to those who embrace the Savior, those who have the humility to acknowledge they're sinners and they need the Savior. You haven't done that, forget about it. It doesn't have to do with you. You can either change your mind and repent and embrace him and be in on it, or you can continue the rest of your life without him. You see? Okay. But anyway, he says, fear not to those who are in Christ. Fear not, I've redeemed you. I've summoned you by name and you are mine. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you. When you pass through the rivers, they won't sweep over you. When you pass through the fire, you will not be burned. The flames will not set you ablaze. For I am the Lord your God. See, he reminds us because I'm sovereign. And I'm the one that's in control of your welfare. For I am the Lord your God, and you are precious and honored in my sight. Not all of you, but those of you who are embracing the Savior. You're precious and honored in my sight, and I love you, he says. And I won't even quote the whole thing, but you, Psalm 23, our favorite psalm. What? The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pasture, etc., etc. That psalm takes on all new meaning when you think of it in terms of this absolute sovereign providential control of God in all things. And how about Lamentations 3:22-23? The steadfast love of the Lord is forever. His mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning. Great is thy faithfulness, because he's sovereign. He can do everything he said, and he will. And how about Psalm 139? O Lord, you have searched me and you know me. You know when I sit and when I rise. You perceive my thought from afar. You discern my going out, my lying down. You're familiar with all my ways. Before a word is upon my tongue, you know it completely, O Lord. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me, too lofty for me to attain. And one last one. You're writing all these down, right? Colossians 1:17. He is before all things, and in him all things hold together. It is he who sustains and keeps us. Let's bow. Father, Lord God, we stand in awe today of your sovereign majesty as we think about your sovereign providential control in all things, in this life, in this world, from the beginning till the end. We're thankful that you have revealed yourself to us and that we know our Maker and our Creator, and that we have come to know you through your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, who you have provided to be the Savior of the world, for all to find salvation in him. And Jesus said, all who come to me, there are some who will not. But he said, all who come to me, I will in no wise cast out. So Lord, any who are apart from the saving knowledge of Jesus here this morning in this assembly need not remain that way. All they have to do is get rid of their pride, their foolish pride, and acknowledge they are sinners like all the rest of us, and embrace the Savior you sent into the world who died on the cross. The wages of sin is death, and Jesus paid the wages of sin for the world because he's the infinite Son of God who died on the cross. And God the Father says, yes, I accept that as a payment for the sins of the world. And that's the transaction that took place on the cross of Calvary. So, Lord, thank you for all of these things. And we pray that you'll now cause the saints of God to be strengthened, built up in the most holy faith from your truth of your doctrine today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. I stand amazed in the presence.
what's the measure? And wonder how he can love me, a sinner condemned, unclean. How marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me. For me it was in the garden he prayed, not my will but thine. He had no tears for his own, but sweat drops of blood for mine. How marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me.
See you all tonight at Knights of the King's Table.
Amen.
Now, the sovereign God is your refuge, and underneath are the everlasting arms. May the peace of God that passes all understanding keep your hearts and minds through this truth. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Ricky's Cabs. Thank you. Radical stuff. That stuff's